Good morning and welcome to Summit Church. We're so glad that you're here. Go ahead and stand. We're going to worship the name of the Lord this morning.
Story, hearts are yearning. Holy, 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 holy
This place with your spirit, Lord. Just fill each of us here. Let us feel your presence as we worship you this morning.
Alleluia, Christ is risen. come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. As you wait for the crown, tell the world of the treasure you found.
You can be seated this morning. We have some announcements for you, so go ahead and take a look.
Good morning and welcome to Summit Church. Today is Family Beach Day, so you might need some of these later. Meet us at Sandy Point from 2 to 5:30. If you like fun in the sun, the beach at Sandy Point is the place for you and your family. Enjoy a dip in the cool water, take a scenic bike ride on the Boise River Greenbelt, or just kick back and relax. Sandy Point offers lots of cool grass and shady trees. An early dinner will be served at 4:30. It's going to be great and it's free. A couple of things you need to be aware of. There is a $5 per vehicle entrance fee and no pets are allowed in the park this summer. If you're new to Summit, like to know more about the church, let us know by checking the "I would like to attend the next welcome lunch" box at the top of our communication card. Then plan on joining Pastor Brian for an informative time on Sunday, July 24th around 12:15 in the living room. If you're visiting with us today, we'd like to give you a Papa Murphy's gift card as our way of saying we're glad you're here. Drop a communication card in one of our offering boxes on your way out, or you can also submit a digital one from the link on our webpage. Remember, for more announcements of upcoming events, check out the bulletin, e-news, church app, digital signs throughout the building, and the website. Have a great day and hope to see you later at Family Beach Day.
That works. Can we get to this camera here? He's running. Craig's running. The switcher must not be working. So for those who are online, I'll stand here and we'll switch it to this camera in a moment. This is what happens with technology when you get to when things change. Hey, this morning we're doing our missions report. Now, here at Summit Church this year, we decided I brought something new. The last Sunday of every month, we're going to feature one of our missionaries so that the names and pictures and so forth on the wall back there won't just be names of people you've never heard. I want to feature one of them every week. Oh, that works well. So we're using that one. We can't switch. Now, this morning's obviously not the last Sunday of the month, but one of our missionaries is in town, and it's John Musgrove from Ukraine, and John won't be here the last Sunday. So obviously, with folks coming and going with world travel, we go with their schedule and don't try to just force it in. So John, come on up. Some of you have heard this. I've known John so long. He was there the night I met Angie for the first time. That's how long John and I have known each other. And Angie and I will celebrate our 33rd anniversary here in a couple of weeks. So we've known each other a long time. Let me hand you that. You guys kind of know the drill here. I'm going to ask John three questions. And the first one is just tell us a little bit about yourself. There's folks here who've not met you. They're new to the church in the last couple of years. And with COVID, I think...
Right.
It's probably been 3 years since you've been here.
Right. It's been, do you guys hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. It's been 3 years since I've been here last time, thanks to COVID. But a little bit about myself. I graduated from Boise State University in 1984. And then in 1986, came on staff with Campus Crusade for Christ crew. And then in January of 1995, went to Ukraine with the crew and have been there now 27 years working with the student ministry.
John seems more Ukrainian to me than American at this point. You've been there, so just like that's your home at this point. So John, I mean, normally we ask you to tell us about what you do and all that. The real question with Ukraine is tell us how the war, all that's, how that's affected your ministry, and then we want to pray for you. So we've heard what you do before, but it's different now. So how do you do what you do now in the middle of a war zone? How has it changed?
Mm-hmm. Well, I'm going to say, the war has greatly impacted what we do. Our reality is much different, but the principles and what God has called us to do is still the same: evangelism and discipleship. And for 3 months after the war started, I lived in Budapest, Hungary, and I'll be going back to Hungary the end of September. But like I said, the war has changed our reality, but the principles of evangelism, discipleship are still there. And so the team I'm working with and other staff, we're doing evangelism, discipleship with refugees in Hungary and also with refugees, internally displaced people in Ukraine. And so we put together a strategy called Yellow Boxes, where we're humanitarian aid. People receive 4 weeks in a row, and each week there's a different message related to the gospel: God's love, sin, salvation, and make a decision.
What else do you want us to know about what you do there and how the war has impacted it?
Well, the war has greatly impacted the ministry in Ukraine. We have 122 staff, and I think maybe 20 are in the Budapest area, Hungary. And but so there's still 100 staff in Ukraine, but they are scattered all over. Most of our staff have moved to Western Ukraine or to small villages, as Russia just keeps firing missiles every day.
And some have been drafted.
We have five staff that have been drafted, and three of those five all have two children, small children. And so, another way that our ministry has changed, we have much more of a military ministry, which started in 2014 when Russia started this war, but now it's greatly increased with five staff being drafted. And as I said, I'll be end of September, September 23rd, a few days after my mom's 85th birthday, I'll be going back to Hungary. If you were here at the presentation last Sunday, I probably said I'll be going to Ukraine or Hungary. But since then, God has spoken through leadership, and they've said, John, you'll be serving Ukrainians in Hungary.
So you're heading back into September. You'll still be stationed in Budapest. And your ministry primarily then to Ukrainians will be with displaced people.
Yes.
How many displaced Ukrainians are there at this point?
Well, in Budapest, there's probably about 200,000.
Wow.
But in Europe itself, probably about 6 million Ukrainian refugees.
6 million Ukrainian refugees. Mm-hmm. Now, to give you perspective, the state of Idaho has 1.5 million people. There are 6 million displaced people because of the war.
Mm-hmm.
So huge humanitarian need. Last question is, how can we be praying for you and your ministry there? And then we're going to pray. Mm-hmm. So what would you like us to pray specifically for today?
Well, pray that God would end this war, and pray that as God ends it, that Russia would realize they've lost, and so not just a ceasefire, because if there's ceasefire, they will sooner or later continue to attack Ukraine. So pray that the war would end, and that Russia would lose, and pray that there would be a spiritual revival in Ukraine.
Now, you said at Sunday's presentation, last week, John did an hour and a half presentation. You said then it would help the gospel reach more people in Ukraine if Russia loses. So your statement, pray Russia loses, isn't just a political preference.
Yeah.
That would further the gospel. Explain
further
that.
Further gospel, and I think I said that more people would be alive.
Right.
And if they're alive, then they can hear the gospel.
Right.
Because, if they just, there's a ceasefire, Sooner or later, they will start to fire more missiles, more people will be killed.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so if they actually realize they've lost, then I think more people will be saved physically, which can result in more people coming to know the Lord.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And what else can we pray for? For you personally? Or?
You can pray. Actually, I have two options of what I can do when I go back to Hungary. Work with Ukrainian students, but travel on a monthly basis. But I also found out I have to get special permission every trip if I go into Ukraine, or work with Ukrainian refugees in Hungary. So pray for the wisdom of that. And also, since I've realized I'm not going to go back into Ukraine to live, pray for wisdom and find a place to live.
Okay.
And then also just pray for wisdom for our leadership, Sasha Zebra from the leadership, and pray that also emotionally I can handle all the loss and pain that Ukraine is going through.
Yeah. So. Yep. Well, let's go to prayer now. Lord, we are thankful for John, for his ministry there. We're thankful that as a church we get to partner with him, and it's good to see him face to face. Many of us have been worried about him. We have prayed for his safety, and it is good to see him. Lord, we pray for the situation there in Ukraine right now. We see in the Word that you are the one who is sovereign over the events of this world, and you are involved, and we ask that you would bring that conflict to a resolution that would allow more people to live and more people to be introduced to you. Lord, we ask that your plan would be furthered in that part of the world. Lord, we pray for John and the ministry there in Ukraine, that there are staff scattered all over. And we see in the Bible, when you scattered your people, that actually furthered your plan. We pray that rather than hindering the gospel, it would help it. But we do pray encouragement for them. This has been hard, and it's difficult for them to see their houses, their apartments, their friends and loved ones die. It's been a really difficult time. So we pray your Spirit would minister to them, to their hearts and souls, that their work matters. As John goes back, we pray again for his safety, that you would watch over him. Or we also pray you give them wisdom as to the best way that John can be used, whether that's with students or whether that's with refugees and displaced people. Give them wisdom. And so, Lord, once again, we are just thankful for John and for his ministry, for the partnership we have. And as he goes, it's kind of like we're sending him out again, but to a different place. That is a different part of the world now than it was a year ago. And we pray he would be a powerful tool in your hand to bring about salvation and discipleship. Pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you very much. And I want to say also, take heart. Everything is terrible what's happening, but God is working in a unique way. So take heart and just continue to support Ukraine. And I want to thank you for that.
Thank you, John. And John, he'll be at second service, obviously, so he'll be out in the lobby. If you want to hear more, maybe you weren't at the thing last Sunday afternoon, you want to hear more about what's going on in his intersection with that, John will be out there in the lobby. So I invite you to talk with him further. Hey, I want to point out the flowers here. We had a funeral yesterday. Karen Lockhart, many of you know Andrew and Karen, part of our church. Karen's dad passed away. We did the funeral yesterday, and they left some of the flowers. And so we're thankful for them. And just wanted to recognize that. Start the service. We're going to do our memory verse. And so we've got new cards. Now, I realized last week we stopped assembling all of, you know, it used to be all during COVID, you had to pick up your bulletin and there was like all that stuff paper clipped together. And we've stopped doing that, but that means you need to pick one of these cards up yourself. It's not like clipped onto your bulletin as you walk in. And there's a whole bunch on a table out there. We invite you to pick one up, but put these someplace where you'll find it, where you'll see it, and then read through the verse. And the goal is by the end of the month, you've got that verse memorized. One of our values here at Summit Church is the Bible study and memorization. That's how we define the ministry of the Word, that we want to know what it says and hide it in our hearts. Like I said, it's hard to obey if we don't know what it says, right? And so we want to know what God's word says. So say this, this is this month's verse. It's John 15:7. Please recite it with me. If you remain in me and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish and it will be done for you. John 15:7. So pick up a card and begin using those. Hey, we are in our summer sermon series. It's called Solid Gold Greatest Hits of the Old Testament, featuring your favorites by Abraham, Isaac, Moses, David, many more. And we're going to do one of those many more today. Today's story may be the least known story on the list. It's not like David and Goliath, Joshua and Jericho, really well known. But I have to tell you, it's one of my favorites. It's one of the ones, as we made the list, it's like, we'll read through much of the story and it's familiar, but it's probably the least known of them. It's the story about the call of Samuel. It's found in 1 Samuel chapter 3, and I believe it goes through the first phrase of chapter 4, verse 1. Samuel is going to become a major figure in the Old Testament. He's the one who anoints the king and all of that. And this story is about how that begins. And as you saw, it's found in the third chapter of the book of 1 Samuel. Now, before we read it, I have to confess something. This one's out of chronological order. I realized this last week. So at the beginning of the summer, we made this list, and I told you we're going to do the greatest hits of the Old Testament, and we made this list, and we distributed among the staff, and there were more stories on the list than we could fit in summer, and so we did this, which ones are going to be included or not, and we established it and sent it out. I'm going to be on vacation for a couple weeks, and so Josh and Ryan will be preaching, and as I went through this week, it's like, wait, we skipped Judges. Two of the stories are in Judges. So we're doing 1 Samuel before Judges. The next couple are going to go backwards. So the mistake was mine when I made the list. I don't know what I was thinking. So I wanted to do them like in the order they appear, but your pastor makes mistakes too. And anyway, that's why we're out of, some of you may be sticklers for that kind of stuff. I know we're not doing it in order. It was my fault. Anyway, with that, let's read the first 11 verses of 1 Samuel chapter 3. I'll have them on the screen. You can open your Bible as well, or the verses are in the mobile app. We have a Bible on the mobile app as well. So read with me 1 Samuel chapter 3, 1 to 11. Now the boy Samuel was attending to the service of the Lord before Eli, and word from the Lord was rare in those days. Visions were infrequent. But it happened at that time as Eli was lying down in his place. Now his eyesight had begun to be poor and he couldn't see well. And the lamp of God had not yet gone out. And Samuel was lying down in the temple of the Lord where the ark of God was, that the Lord called Samuel. And he said, "Here I am." And then he ran to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." But he said, "I didn't call. Go back and lie down." So he went back and laid down. And the Lord called Samuel yet again, "Samuel." So Samuel got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." But he said, "I didn't call you, my son. Go back and lie down." Now Samuel did not yet know the Lord, nor had the word of the Lord yet been revealed to him. So the Lord called Samuel again for the third time, and he got up and he went to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." And then Eli realized it was the Lord calling the boy. And Eli said to Samuel, "Go lie down, and it shall be if he calls you that you shall say, 'Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening.'" So Samuel went and lay down in his place, and then the Lord came and stood and called, as at other times, "Samuel, Samuel." And Samuel said, "Speak, for your servant is listening." And then the Lord said to Samuel, "Behold, I'm going to do a thing in Israel, and both ears of everyone who hears about it will ring." And then he goes on to give a message. We'll stop there. Verses 1 to 3 kind of give the setting for this story. We see in verse 1 that the boy Samuel is ministering before the Lord, and a guy named Eli is the high priest. Verse 3 says that Samuel was laying down in the temple of the Lord. Now, the temple as a building hadn't actually been built yet. At this point in time, it's a tabernacle. The tabernacle is kind of a tent. It's kind of like a movable temple. You know how we live in houses? But when you go camping, you take a tent or an RV, and it's kind of like a movable place to live. That's kind of what the tabernacle was. Solomon's going to build the building that's called the temple. But before that, they had this thing called the tabernacle, which is a tent that they could move around. It started with Moses and all of that, and that's where the ark was kept in the temple. Anyway, That's the place where this takes place. The physical one hasn't been built yet until Solomon comes along. Now, we don't know how old Samuel was. It uses the word boy there as we read this. The word boy shows up a couple times. So he's under 13, right? Because that would be the age at which a Jewish boy would be considered a man. The Jewish historian Josephus puts him at 12 years old, but Josephus was born in 37 AD, which by most accounts is like 1,000 years after this story takes place. The truth is, we really don't know how old he was other than he's a boy. I've always kind of pictured him in the 10, 11, 12 range. And so the reason that Samuel is at the tabernacle is told in chapters 1 and 2. We picked up with chapter 3. His mom, Hannah, was unable to have kids. And so she prayed to the Lord that she could have a child. She said, if I have a child, I'll dedicate him to your service. And she did have a kid, and she named him Samuel, and she followed through with that promise. She took him to the tabernacle to be raised there, and that's why he's here. That's what the first two chapters are about. So he's there the tabernacle. Now, Eli, the high priest, is hardly a pillar of spiritual maturity. And there's a few clues for that here in the verses that we read. First of all, it says the word of the Lord was rare in those days. Now, you got to remember, they couldn't like go on Amazon and order a copy of the Bible and have it delivered with two-day prime delivery, right? That's when they say the word of the Lord, it actually came through people. Like Eli. And that's not, God is not speaking through Eli because he's not a godly man. He is not a good guy, and God is not speaking through him. It also said in the verses we read that the lamp hadn't yet gone out. There was this lamp that they kept in there, and apparently it hadn't gone out yet. If you go back and you read Exodus chapter 27, you find out it was never supposed to go out. Right? It was kind of like the eternal flame. So the fact that it's going out every night is kind of a clue that these guys aren't following through with what they're supposed to do, and God's not speaking to them. Now, there's more information about Eli and his two sons back in chapter 2, and it does not paint a pretty picture. First, they are taking the portion of the sacrifice by force. So what would happen is the guys that served at the tabernacle and in the temple, the priests, they would get their food and make their living off part of the stuff that was given as the sacrifice, okay? And so people would bring their tithes and all of that, and the food that they ate was part of that. And they had this system that would randomly determine what they would eat. Back in chapter 2, you read that these guys have abandoned that system and are taking the best meat for themselves by force, okay? They're forcing the people to hand that over. And then secondly, they're sleeping with the women who served there. That at the tabernacle, there were women who served and did service, and his sons are sexually assaulting and raping the women who served there. And so that's the setting where this story takes place. We've got a boy named Samuel who's been raised at the tabernacle by a high priest who is not a good guy, and his two sons who are really bad also. And then something happens in verse 4. Something happens, and this is where God calls to Samuel. This is the action of the story, and it's where we find some things that are very instructive for us. The first thing I want you to see is that in verse 7, it says straight out, Samuel did not yet know the Lord. That's what it says in verse 7. Now, Samuel did not yet know the Lord. Now, think about that for a second. Samuel essentially grew up at church, right? I mean, he was raised there, and he saw the sacrifices, he saw the worship, he heard the songs, he watched everything going on every day. His whole life is basically church. He knew a whole lot about all of that, but he didn't know the Lord. He did not yet know the Lord, is what it says in verse 7. And that's the first lesson, that going to church doesn't mean you know God. Right? We've got Samuel here who's been going to church a whole lot. I mean, you can go to church a whole lot and yet not know the Lord. Now, let's be clear about the goal here. You know, I say going to church doesn't mean you know God. Let's be clear about the goal. The goal isn't to get people to come to church. Our goal isn't to get folks into this building on Sunday mornings. And you might be surprised to hear your pastor say that. I obviously have strong beliefs about church, and I think church is important and plays a role in our lives. But sometimes we confuse that with the main goal. We act as though getting people to attend church is the main goal. It's not. The goal is for folks to know the Lord. And church plays a role in that. But the goal is that they know the Lord, not just to get them inside the building. And this is an area where I think COVID actually helped us. During COVID, there was a time when we couldn't meet in the building, and it forced us to evaluate, you know, how do we do ministry? And that's a good thing. That's actually a good... We found we could still do a whole lot of stuff without this building, right? In fact, if you look at church history, the very first Christian church was built in Aqaba, Jordan. They placed the date at about 293 to 303 AD. And what that means is Christians did church for like three centuries without buildings. Think about that, right? And so they understood the goal for those 300 years was to make disciples and see the gospel get spread. Now, I think buildings are wonderful. We have a great facility, and we can use this facility to accomplish that goal. But the goal isn't to get people in church, because going to church doesn't mean you know the Lord. Here's verse 7 with a guy who grew up there, and he does not yet know the Lord. Doesn't yet know the Lord. Now, this is part of why we regularly present the gospel at Summit Kids. At Second Service, we have Summit Kids downstairs growing up in this church, and we want them to know God, and we present the message of salvation multiple times throughout the year. At Summit Kids and at Awana. And at events like VBS, we had somebody receive Jesus at VBS. And, you know, over the last 10 to 15 years, actually probably further, but even when Jim was pastor, I would do a lot of the meetings with people who wanted to get baptized. Jim was really busy, so I'd meet with them. And one of the questions I'd always ask them, tell me when you received Jesus. And with kids, oftentimes it was, I heard the gospel at my Sunday school class. I heard my Awana teacher do it. When I got home, mom and dad prayed the prayer with me. It's a wonderful thing. And part of what I love about this story in 1 Samuel is that God is calling a kid. God's speaking to a boy. You know, it's easy for us, I think, to get focused on adult ministry, and we miss the fact that God is speaking and calling out to kids, right? That's super important to see, the focus and the importance of children's ministry just within this. Samuel's going to be a major player in the plan of God, and God calls to him as a boy. We don't want to miss that fact and the importance of that. That, like many of you, I received Jesus when I was a kid. In fact, I heard God's call on, will I follow him wherever that might be, at a camp when I was in fifth or sixth grade. And I didn't fully understand what all that meant when I was like 12 years old. It was fifth or sixth grade. But I knew what I was committing myself to, follow him wherever that might be. If you're a parent and God is speaking to your kids, take that seriously. If you're a kid and you hear God speaking to you, take that seriously. We don't want to discount that, because here we have a boy in Scripture and God is speaking to him. I think within this story also, there's a danger or a warning for us as adults as well. It's possible for us to spend lots of time learning about God and yet never actually get to know him better as a person. I know folks who spend a lot of time reading books about the Bible, more time reading books about the Bible than they do reading the Bible, right? And you go, well, that doesn't seem right. And again, I've got lots of great books in my office on the shelves and all of that, but the goal isn't to know about God, it's to know the Lord. Right? And here's the boy Samuel, and he's grown up at the temple. He's probably 10, 11, 12 years old, or at the tabernacle, and he does not yet know the Lord. And then something happens. God speaks to him, right? Calls him by name. He knows his name, right? Samuel. And that's the second lesson we see here, is that God reveals himself and we respond. That's what takes place here. God calls out, and then Samuel has a response. We're going to take those two separately, okay? Because I think there's two actions here. There's God calling, God revealing himself. It said he didn't know him yet. He hadn't yet revealed himself. God's going to do that. And then Samuel has a response to make. So first, let's look at God speaking. I find the interaction kind of funny here between Samuel and the Lord and Eli. You know, God keeps calling, and Samuel keeps going to Eli, And there's this, well, I didn't call you, go back. And then it calls again, well, I didn't call you, go back. You know, and there's this thing going on. I think there's something instructive here for us as well. Something that about how God reveals himself. Have you ever wondered what the voice of God sounds like? Don't you kind of picture it?
Brian, this is God.
You know, sort of that booming, thunderous voice, right? And that's kind of how we picture it. I read this story, you know what I think he sounds like? He sounds like Eli, right? I mean, he confuses it a bunch of times thinking it's Eli. Here at least, I'm not saying he always does that because I'm going to read you another section in a moment. But it looks to me from this story like God's voice sounds a whole lot like Eli's voice. And what I mean here is that it looks like God chose to reveal himself in a way that Samuel needed. We have a boy here sleeping in the tent of meeting and God doesn't thunder and roar. He sounds familiar, doesn't he? He sounds familiar to him. Compare that to the way God revealed himself to Isaiah. This is from Isaiah chapter 6. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord seated on a throne, high and exalted. The train of his robe filled the temple. Above him were seraphs, each with six wings. And with two wings they covered their faces, and with two they covered their feet, and with two they were flying, and they were calling out to one another, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. The earth is full of his glory." And at the sound of their voices, the doorposts and the thresholds shook, and the temple was filled with smoke. Think about that. The doorposts are shaking, and the threshold, and it's filled with smoke. I think if God revealed himself that way to an 11-year-old kid, it would have scared the pants off him, right? So God chooses to reveal himself to people in a way that is helpful for his plan. That's how Isaiah needed to see it for what God was calling him to do and be. But what we see here is that God is personal. He wants us to know him, and he speaks and reveals himself to people in ways that are most helpful at making that happen. Right? That's what's going on here. God wants Samuel to have this relationship with him, and he reveals himself in a way that will facilitate that. I believe God calls out to us today. I believe still God is still calling to people today. It was Blaise Pascal who said there's a God-shaped vacuum inside the heart of each man which cannot be satisfied by any created thing but only by God the Creator made known through Jesus Christ. That's the whole quote by Blaise Pascal. And the idea is that we have this longing in our souls. We have this hole inside, this yearning, and only God can satisfy it. I think God is still calling out to us, to our hearts and souls. And the tragic thing is that today, a lot of people respond just like Samuel did. He heard the voice and assumed it was Eli, right? So in other words, he heard the voice but went somewhere else. And I think that happens today. People are aware of that void within and they go to the wrong thing. And they try to fill it with other stuff, just like he tried to go to Eli over and over again. And finally, Eli sends him back. You know, the people think, well, you know, boy, life just isn't. What I need is I need a new job. I just need a different job. My career and all that, that'll actually satisfy me. Or a nicer car. A nicer car would satisfy that longing inside me. If I had a cabin at the lake, I could get away. And I'd really feel content if I could just get away from it all. You know, some people self-medicate through alcohol or drugs or porn. You know, I just need a younger wife, a younger, sexier wife, and then it'll be okay. And none of these truly satisfy. I've talked with people who had an affair and wrecked their families and their kids and all that, and later they were like, what was I thinking? And they can't go back, right? And they tried to fill that with other things, and God continues to call. Doesn't he? What I love about the story is that God keeps calling, and he keeps calling, right? And we see him call out four times. God continues to call. Why? Because he's personal, and he wants us to know him. I know a lot of folks here on Sunday mornings already know the Lord, but I don't assume that's true for everyone. In fact, I hope, you've heard me say this, I hope every week there are folks in this room who do not yet know the Lord and are here to figure out if God is real and I can know him. I hope that's true every single week, that we are reaching more and more people who want to find out if that's true. If that's you today, will you respond? Will you respond to God calling you? I know two people personally whose experience is similar to this in that they heard God actually call their name. One of them was a guy named Dan Kincaid. Some of you know Dan. He was sitting right back over here, and Jim Steiner was the pastor. Then he said, boy, if you hear God call your name, and Dan said he heard it, and he looked up, and everybody had their head bowed and all that, but he said he heard God call his name, and he responded that day. Another guy, Tony Hutter, many of you remember Tony. He was a guy I'd been working with, and Tony had volunteered to mow the lawn at church while our facilities guy was gone, and the riding mower broke, and he's a really faithful guy, so he was doing the push mower out here. He's mowing our grass with the push mower, and the mower's going, and he had things in his ears, and he said he heard his voice, and he stopped and turned around. There was nobody there. And then he was like, I wouldn't heard it anyway. I had the mower going and all the stuff, and I said, Tony, God's calling you, and he said, I know. And Tony responded. Now, not everybody has that kind of experience. I mean, I know lots of people who know the Lord and only two who said they heard it audibly. The goal is not to have that experience. The goal is to know the Lord. Will you respond that God still calls to folks today? God still calls to folks today. Will you respond to his voice? And that brings us to Samuel's response. God reveals himself. That's the first part. And we respond, and we respond. Eli finally figures out what's going on and points Samuel to God. And by the way, that's the job of a priest. A priest is meant to be a go-between between God and people, and the job of the priest is to point people, connect them with God. In the New Testament, that's our job, right? We are priests, according to the New Testament. Our job is to help people who don't know God get connected with him. That's part of what God's called us to do. So finally, Eli figures that out, and Samuel's response in verse 10, I believe, is an example for us to follow. He says, speak, for your servant is listening. This is a model for responding to God. Speak, for your servant is listening. This is the posture that we should take every time we seek God. Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. That's what he says. Eli gives him really good advice there, and that's what Samuel finally says. Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. I've been a pastor for over 30 years now, and I've been asked numerous times, how do I discern God's voice? And what folks usually want is some kind of formula, right? Give me a four-step plan. You know, give me the four-step plan that will help me do that. And I don't find formulas very helpful here. And the reason is that God's a person and we're to have a relationship with him. And formulas don't usually help in personal relationships. Think about this question. Suppose somebody came to you and they said, Brian, can you give me a four-step plan for discerning my wife's voice? Right? And we go, well, how about just meeting with her alone and saying, speak, honey, for your husband's listening, right? I mean, that makes way more sense than a four-step plan for discerning what her voice might be. Now, I use that example because it's an area where I'm not very good in the morning. I love to read the newspaper. We still get a physical paper delivered to our house, even though these days I usually read it online on my laptop. We actually get the Idaho Statesman delivered to our house. And I read the whole thing. I read the national news. I read the local news. I read the sports page. I read the op-ed page, the comics page. I do the jumble, you know, the little puzzle there. I do the seven little words puzzle. I read the obits. I read the whole thing. And when Angie talks to me in the morning and I've got my head in the paper, I don't hear a word she says. And we've talked about this because she'll speak and I am not listening. My focus is completely somewhere else. I'm just busy with lots of other stuff. For you, it might be your phone that distracts you. There may be other things, but somebody speaks to you and you aren't listening. And I think the same thing often happens in our relationship with God. We're so busy with other stuff that we don't stop and listen to what God might be saying. Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. Samuel is all by himself in the quiet of the tabernacle when God speaks to him. Do you have space in your life for that? Where it's quiet and the distractions are put away and you can say, speak, for your servant is listening, and you're open to what God might say? Or is your life so busy, there's no margins for that at all? There's just not time to be quiet and to listen to the voice of God. I believe God speaks to us today. He speaks to us through prayer and through his word. At Summit Church, we have five habits. We've got a whole wall out there, and it says on the board there, God cares about me. I nurture my relationship with him through practicing those five habits. One of those five habits is daily devotion, spending time with God each day, that he becomes the focus of our attention during that time. It's how we grow in our relationship. Excuse me. That we need to meet with him and hear what he has to say for us. Daily devotions isn't something we encourage because we don't think your lives are busy enough. You know, the folks at Summit just need more stuff to do, right? I mean, the truth is, we are all so busy. We believe it's valuable to carve that time out so that we can say something like this, speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. That's what we need to hear. You know, this has happened to me. I'm trying to be quiet. I'm trying to focus in on God. And my phone will make one of those notifications, right? And suddenly I'm distracted. And at that point, I've got a decision to make. Do I want to have God be the focus of my time and hear what he has for me? Or do I want to know what somebody sent me through a text message or Facebook Messenger or an email I got? Whose voice do I want to hear right then? Now, the convicting thing is I know that what God has for me is more important than anything that might come across this device. But there's still that struggle, isn't there? To actually say, I'm going to give God my attention and say, speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. This also shows, I believe, that when we pray, we need to include times where we aren't talking. I think a lot of folks, many folks view prayer as talking to God. Right? So when I pray, I do all the talking. And yet the Psalms are filled with, I waited for the Lord, wait silently before him. I think our times before God have to include daily devotions and prayer need to include times of silence where we can say this response, speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. And then we wait to hear what he says. And he may speak to us through his word. He may speak to us through prayer, through other people. But God still speaks today, and we have to allow time for that, waiting patiently for him. I believe the ability to discern God's word, God's voice, is one of the most important skills in life. And you all know that I'm a mathematical, analytical guy. I wish I could give you that four-step plan, but it's just not that easy. Let me tell you a story about discerning God's voice just from my own life. When I finished school and was looking for a job as a pastor, I actually first interviewed at another church in town. And for a job of youth pastor, they had a separate junior high and senior high group. They had some volunteers, and they were looking for a full-time youth pastor. And I met with the pastor. I met the guy, really liked him. We went on a Sunday morning. I heard him preach. He'd grown up in Campus Crusade, and I was involved in Campus Crusade. It all looked good. We went and visited the kids. And we prayed it through, and I thought, I don't think this is the right job. And I can't really describe what, it's not like I heard this voice, Brian, don't take that way. You know, it's not, but I prayed it through, said, speak, that, yeah, I want to follow your plan. And I told him no. I told the guy, no, I don't think this is what God's calling me to do. Well, apparently, Jim, who was the pastor here, was at a prayer meeting with some pastors and mentioned that he was looking for a youth pastor. And this guy, Tom, said, well, I interviewed this guy and wanted to hire him. You should call him. So I got a call out of the blue from a guy named Jim Steiner, who said, some of you know Jim, he was my predecessor. And Jim says, you've never met me, but Tom gave me your name and number. Can I interview you for a job? So I went and I interviewed with Jim. Now, the job here was very part-time. There were 8 teenagers in the whole church, and it was going to be $1,000 a month to be part-time. And there were no volunteers, and there was no youth ministry at all. It was like, build it from scratch. We don't have anything. And we prayed it through. I told Angela, it's like, I think this is the place God's calling us to go. And at face value, that doesn't make much sense. The other, it was like a full-time, and it had like a developed ministry, and here we got 8 kids, and it's really part-time, and we weren't even sure how we were going to buy a house and do all of that, right? But it's like, I think this is what God wants us to do, and that has been confirmed. I believe that God did call us here, and he blessed that and so forth. So what I said, I believe verse 10 is a model for us to follow. It shows us the right spiritual posture when we're seeking God, and we need to include time for that. Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. We need to include that in our times with God each day. Now, we don't have time to look at the message God gave Samuel in verses 11 to 18. It's a message of judgment on Eli and his two kids. But here's the thing. The message had already been revealed to Eli by a man of God at the end of chapter 2. There was this man of God who came and brought this message of judgment to Eli. And so here now God speaks to Samuel and he brings the same message. Now this is important because it confirmed that it was the Lord speaking. God's never going to contradict himself, right? When we're seeking God's will, he's not going to contradict himself. I have literally had somebody say to me that God spoke to them and told them to do something, but it was contrary to the revealed word of God. And I got to go, I don't think that was God speaking, right? I mean, I had somebody say to me once, I think God's calling me to divorce my wife and marry this other person. It's like, I don't think that's God speaking here, right? And so the message here that God revealed through Samuel against Eli and his sons is it's a replica of what he had already said, that God is always consistent in the things that he said. When he speaks to us through his word, or he speaks to us through prayer to other people, it has to line up with what he has already said. There are some lessons for us in the final verses here as well. This is verse 19 to 21, the end of 1 Samuel chapter 3. Now, Samuel grew, and the Lord was with him, and he let none of his words fail. And all Israel, from Dan even to Beersheba, knew that Samuel was confirmed as a prophet of the Lord. And the Lord appeared again at Shiloh, because the Lord revealed himself to Samuel at Shiloh by the word of the Lord. You see verse 21 there? The Lord appeared again at Shiloh, because the Lord revealed himself to Samuel at Shiloh by the word of the Lord. Isn't that a huge contrast from how this chapter began? Remember how the chapter began? The word of the Lord was rare, and there weren't very many visions. And here, things have changed. God is appearing again, and his word is going out. Samuel responded to the Lord, and things changed. Verse 19 to 21 say that the Lord was with Samuel and let none of his words fall. That's the mark of a prophet, right? That the words that he says become true. A prophet can say, "Thus saith the Lord," and then finish that sentence, right? I mean, that's kind of what a prophet can do, that they actually speak the very words of God. And so, and then they finish that sentence. And this was true of Samuel, and everybody recognizes it, that his words didn't fail because they originated with God. It's a function of God, not Samuel. Things were different, and everyone recognized it, right? And that's the lesson here. Things change when we respond. Right? God reveals himself, we respond. When we respond, things change. That God works through us to advance his plan. That's what's going to happen with Samuel. God's going to work through Samuel to advance his plan. And others confirm his action in our lives. People confirmed that he was, wow, God's really speaking through Samuel. Others see it. Samuel responded to God's call and things changed. They changed for the world around him, and others saw that work. Verse 20 says he was confirmed as a prophet. All Israel, from Dan to Beersheba, knew that Samuel was confirmed as a prophet. The city of Dan is way up in the north of Israel, and Beersheba's down at the south. So when they say all Israel from Dan to Beersheba, it'd be kind of like the American phrase, from sea to shining sea, right? When we say from sea to shining sea, you go, oh, that means all of America, right? When you see that phrase in the Bible, from Dan to Beersheba, it's kind of like from the top all the way to the, it's a north-south reference there. And they all recognize that God is using him, and they can see it. And I believe that's what happens today. When we respond to what God is saying to us, what he's calling us to do, things change, and others see it. Now, in the New Testament, it says that God gives people spiritual gifts.
and uses them to accomplish his work today. Some people are pastors like me, and others are evangelists and teachers. Others are gifted at administration, and some people are gifted at hospitality. We need people good at hospitality for hosting Bible studies and doing things. There's all these lists of things that God has gifted people of that, and we need all of those to get God's work done. God wants to use regular folks like you and me to get his work done, to get his work done. I got to say, being used by God is one of the greatest things ever. I mean, you can hear me say, boy, God uses people to get his work done. You go, boy, Brian's trying to twist my arm here. No, I want you to experience, it's like addictive. God uses you to like change things and you go, that was so great. I want to do that again. Right? I mean, that, and if you've been on missions trips or you've worked in Awana or Summit Kids and you see lives change, you go, that's like the greatest thing ever. And you just want to do that over and over and over again. And that's what we have here. Samuel's being used by God and others confirm that. And that's what he wants to do today. I don't want this to be some kind of guilt trip to try to guilt you into serving. You'll find your place where God wants to use you, and others will confirm that. Others will confirm it as they see him working through you. So two things here. First, this isn't just for folks who are pastors or like Samuel, who's going to be this prophet. God wants to use everyone. Everyone here has a role to play. Are you playing your part? You know, we miss out if you aren't, right? If everybody has a role to play and somebody doesn't play their part, well, then the church misses out. When everybody plays their part, things really get rolling. And that's what we want to have happen here at Summit Church. The work of this church and the changes God wants to bring about in our city and in our community will happen when we all respond to what God is calling us to do. But secondly, I think the other side of this is if you see God using someone, tell them. It's part of that confirmation. When I was in college, I was involved in Campus Crusade, and I was at this Bible study, and the leader said, boy, Brian, some of the things you share at Bible study are really good. Have you thought maybe you ought to lead a group? It's like, no, I never thought about that. He's like, you might be really good at teaching God's word to others, and I think that's where my gifts are. But somebody recognized that in me and told me and said, you should try this. If you see God working through someone and you say, boy, I think you've got the gift of... And there's 25 of them listed. You fill in the blank. Say, have you thought that maybe that's how God wants to use you? You should tell them. It'll be encouraging for them, and it will confirm how God uses them within the body of Christ, right? So we see this confirmation of Samuel at the end of this chapter. A similar thing happens today as we see God working in and through others. If you see God working in someone, tell them. Tell them. Say, boy, God's using you this way, and maybe you should do that more. Maybe you should do that more. I love this story. You can tell this is one of my favorites. I get excited about 1 Samuel chapter 3. But I want to close by saying, speak for your servants are listening, right? That to me, that's like one of the main things. This is how we should respond to God. Speak for your servant is listening. Let's pray. Lord, we come before you and we have now spent time in your word. And I say, speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. And Lord, we're gathered here. I trust the hearts and souls of the folks gathered in this room with me are saying that same thing before you. Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. We ask, I ask on behalf of this church as a pastor and shepherd that you would reveal yourself to us as a church, but you'd reveal yourself to individuals gathered here like we see with Samuel, that they would know what you've called them to do and where you've called them to go, that your will and your voice would be clear and discernible to us. Lord, may we carve out time in our busy lives for this very thing, that as Samuel was in the quiet of the tabernacle, may we have quiet time before you, and we ask that you would speak and that we would listen. Lord, may this world be different because of our response to your word. Pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Go ahead and stand as we sing the closing song today. Amazing love that was
sinner saved, the work of your power. God, you're so good. God, you're so good. God, you're so good. You're so
week. Thank you for worshiping with us this morning at Summit Church.